Welcome to Chemistry with Caroline. In this video, we're going to take a look at chemical shift in the carbon-13 NMR. So chemical shift is where a signal shows up on your NMR spectrum. For a carbon-13 NMR, the chemical shift range is quite a bit larger than proton NMR. So you're talking 0 to 200 ppm instead of 0 to 12. And that's because the groups that are impacting chemical shift are like directly attached to the carbon, as opposed to a hydrogen attached to a carbon attached to something. So it's different in the size of the scale, but the principles are exactly the same. So the small numbers are upfield. Signals that show up upfield are shielded. The larger numbers are downfield, and signals that show up downfield are deshielded. So I'm going to sketch us sort of a general chemical shift map for the carbon-13 NMR, and then we'll look at a specific example of a molecule, and we'll place signals according to where we should observe them based on chemical shift or type of carbon that we're seeing. So from about 70 all the way up to zero, so I'll just put a little label on here, this would be sp3 hybridized carbons. So any carbons in your molecule that are sp3 hybridized will show up in this range. Carbons that are just attached to other carbons will show up sort of at the top of that range. And then carbons that are attached to a heteroatom or some other functional group are going to show up further downfield in that range, so more towards the bigger number, 70. Between about 70 and 90 would be sp hybridized carbons. So those would be triple bonds. So your alkynes, the cyanotype group, that carbon that's part of the triple bond shows up in that range. And then from about 100 down to like 160-ish are sp2 hybridized carbons. And carbon-carbon double bonds that are isolated would be higher in that range. And then a benzene ring would be a little bit further downfield. But either way, you're going to have sp2 hybridized carbons there. And then the last thing that you'll see show up from about 170 to 200 is carbonyl carbons. So these are very deshielded. You've got a pretty strong dipole moment, right, going towards that oxygen atom. So that's really deshielding those carbonyl carbons, and they show up really far downfield. Nothing else really shows up down there. So again, these are ranges. You don't have to be completely married to exactly where something is. If something shows up at 75, it could still be an sp3 hybridized carbon. Maybe it just has a fluorine on it. So use it as a good guide as to what type of neighbor there is next to the carbon that you're looking at for that signal and what type of carbon it is, sp3, sp2, sp, or a carbonyl carbon. So here I have a specific molecule, and we're going to sketch the carbon-13 NMR of it based on the number of signals and the chemical shift. So if you haven't watched the video on the number of signals that you should expect, go back and watch that first. So if I start from the left, this is carbon-1, carbon-2, carbon-3, carbon-4, and carbon-5. There's no symmetry in this molecule, so I'd expect 5 unique signals. If I then go to put my signals on, carbon-1 and carbon-5 are both sp3 hybridized, so they would be at the top of my spectrum. They're going to be more shielded. Carbon-1 is next to another carbon, but it's an sp2 hybridized carbon, carbon-2. So that maybe is going to show up a little bit downfield because of that sp2 neighbor, but still sort of in the top of that range. Carbon-5 is attached directly to an oxygen. That's a pretty electronegative atom. If you remember, those sp3 hybridized carbons show up in the 0 to 70-ish range, oxygen being pretty electronegative. Maybe that shows up at 5. Now remember, there's no splitting in the carbon-13 NMR, so I'm just drawing a single peak there. Carbon-4 is a carbonyl carbon. Those are the really deshielded downfield ones, so I can stick that down here. So here's 4, here's 1, and here's 5. Now, 2 and 3 are both going to be, you know, a little past 100, maybe like in the 120-ish range. In terms of their relative chemical shift, one thing that we can look to is resonance to sort of show us the electronic environment around that carbon, and then from there, how much shielding it would be experiencing. So I'm going to do a little resonance here. I'm going to take the pi bond between carbon 2 and 3, push it over, and then push electrons up onto the oxygen there. And so that would give me this resonance contributor. Where I have a positive on carbon 2. So carbon 2 having a partial positive charge sort of overall on the molecule, if we think about all the resonance contributors, because we can draw a resonance structure where there's a full positive charge on it, is going to be more deshielded. It's going to be more downfield. And so when I look at this, I'm going to have two peaks that are pretty close to one another in that, you know, 100 to 150-ish range. Carbon 2 is going to be a little bit deshielded because of that partial positive charge due to the resonance contribution of the molecule that I've drawn on the right there. Carbon 3 will be a little bit more shielded. Remember, the more electron density there is around a nuclei, the less that nuclei will feel the applied magnetic field. And as a result, the signal will show up higher, more upfield in the chemical shift region that you would expect it to show up. So this has been a look at carbon-13 NMR and chemical shift. If you found this video helpful, please like, subscribe, and share with your friends.